Today, I'm gonna be concluding our series, Chance of a Lifetime. And I've been on vacation the last 2 weeks and it's been awesome, but I'll be honest, I was ready to come back. And that's a good thing. You know you love your job and you love your church when you're ready to come back from vacation to be here with you guys. I love you guys and I'm excited to be back. Yeah, whatever, you can clap. Some of you are like, I didn't even want you back. But I just gotta say this too. The last 2 weeks, I tuned in and watched, the last 2 weeks have been amazing. Pastor Chris Baldwin last Sunday, I think he deserves a huge round of applause. What an amazing word. And then also the week before that, we had 5 different communicators from our staff preach, and wow, they were just amazing. Can we give them another huge round of applause? It's been really cool to watch the first 2 weeks, but today I'm concluding our series, Chance of a Lifetime, and I am excited to be bringing you this word today. Hopefully it's encouraging for you. When it comes to this series, though, our core theme verse is on the screen behind me, Jeremiah 6:16, and it says this: this is what the Lord says, stand at the crossroads and look, ask for the ancient paths, ask where the good way is, and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls. I think with all the conversations that I've had with people lately, and coming out of the pandemic, and even outside of all the pandemic stuff, just with life, people want rest. You want peace. In the midst of all the chaos in this life and all the turmoil and uncertainty and everything going on in the world, what people want most fundamentally is peace and rest. And this verse tells us how to have that. When we stand at these different moments in our lives, at these crossroad moments of what's gonna happen now and what's gonna happen in our world and what is my life gonna look like? What choices am I gonna make today? Am I gonna go this way or that way? What the Bible tells us is look to the past, look to the word of God, although written in the past is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Look to the ancient paths, walk in the good way, find what the good way is. And we know that way is the Bible, the word of God. It is timeless. It's forever. These truths were true when it was written. They're true today and will always be true. When we look at this sermon series, Chance of a Lifetime, to open up today, I want you to really grasp that. You have a chance of a lifetime today, right now. And I'm going to prove it to you. If you have your Bibles, you can turn quickly to Psalm 139, but I'll be mostly in Genesis today. But to set this up, Psalm 139, 13 and 16 says, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. The psalmist here is writing to God about God, and this is what he's saying. He's saying, look, you, God, you knew me long before I was born. All the days of my life were planned out by you because you're a good God, an all-knowing God. You're the God that's already in the future. All the days of my life were planned. You want to know what that means? And the reason why I'm setting this message up today with this is this one verse tells us, among thousands of others in the Word of God, if all of your days have been seen by God, that means you have a very specific plan and purpose for your life. What this means is no one was born by accident. No one came into this world, no matter what the circumstances were that brought you into this world, God chose for you to be born for such a time as this, right now, with a specific plan and a specific purpose. Now, when I say that, though, that's encouraging, but at the same time, a lot of us are thinking that may have been the plan a long time ago, but I think I might have messed up this plan. I've let a long time go by pushing off the plan of God. Maybe at one time I kind of knew what God wanted me to do with my life, but man, so much has happened. And you're asking, is it too late? Can I get back on track? Some of you are questioning still, even after I said that, do I even have a specific plan for my life? It doesn't feel like it, but if there's one thing I can tell you that is consistent throughout the entire Word of God, it is the fact that you, specifically you, God calls you by name and says, I have a plan for you. And we're gonna look at a story today in the Bible where I'm gonna prove to you that God does have a plan for you. And honestly, God is so big, your mistakes can't even mess up that plan. One person. Okay, that was good. Okay, here we go. All right. The person I wanna look at in scripture today is Abraham. And if you have your Bibles, the first passage I'll be in is Genesis 12. But Abraham is this guy that, I mean, he's one of the most famous guys in scripture. Three current world religions today find their origins in Abraham. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam all trace their origins back to Abraham. He is called Father Abraham, the father of many nations, which we'll get to in a second. Anybody ever grow up singing the song Father Abraham? You wanna sing it real quick? Father Abraham had many sons had I don't wanna sing anymore. Okay, so I'm looking down at Mandy and she's a singer and she's like, okay. So Father Abraham, why is he called Father Abraham? That's what we're gonna look at. And this entire story about Abraham though is the story of God's promise to an imperfect person who honestly, inadvertently tried everything he could to mess up God's promise, but it was still there. It was still there, and Abraham ended up having access to it. But we have to figure out how and what the promise means. So when we look at this story, we have to understand a few things about God's promise. God's promise for your life and how you can know it's a promise from God when you think about, has God promised me something? Is there a calling, a specific plan or purpose for my life? How you know it's from God is this. If I receive it from God, God wants to for me to not only receive it, but for it to pass through me. And when it passes through me, it builds his kingdom. It either draws people to him or advances the kingdom of God. That's how you know it's a purpose of God. It may not be the purpose of God for you to be the starting quarterback. Or it might be if you use that to build the kingdom of God. You guys follow me? So there's so many different elements of this, but when God promises something, if there's one thing I can tell you, if he promises it, it's going to come to pass because God is not just a promise maker, he is a promise keeper. So when we look at the story of Abraham, it's really the story of Abraham and Sarah, but when we look at this story, we find out a little bit later on, God actually changes their names to Abraham and Sarah, and originally their names are Abram and Sarai. So kind of through this message, I'm gonna be kind of going back and forth between those two names. Don't get confused. It's Abram, Abraham, same guy. Sarai, Sarah, same lady. Starting in Genesis 12, 1-2, it says this. The Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. This is the promise from God to Abraham. This is the first time it occurs. Abraham, I'm gonna make you a father of many nations. I'm gonna make you into a great nation. I'm gonna bless you. But the first thing he says is, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to a land I will show you. Now, what's our first response to God if he says, go somewhere? What would we say? Where? God did not tell him where. He said, Abraham, go to a land I will show you. And Abraham had so much faith at the beginning of this story, he just goes, okay. And he starts moving and trusting that God would show him where to go. I think it's interesting how much faith God requires of us that most of the time we're not willing to operate in. God says, go somewhere. And we go, well, I'm gonna have to know where. I'm gonna have to know if it fits in my budget. I'm gonna have to know all the details, God, before I take one step. That's kind of what we do, right? But what God shows us here is he's actually God and we aren't. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. And you will be a blessing. There goes that whole, I'm gonna bless you to be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. All the people on earth will be blessed through you. So this is what he's saying. I'm gonna bless you, and you are going to be made into a great nation. You're gonna have descendants. You're gonna be the beginning of a new people, a new nation. And then he says, whoever blesses that people, that nation, I will bless. Whoever curses that nation, I will curse. What is that nation? Abraham, right? God introduces himself in the Old Testament as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob, after he wrestles with God in that famous story, God changes his name to Israel. Israel, Jacob, has 12 sons, the 12 tribes of Israel. Abraham's descendants are Israel. The New Testament would be the church of Jesus Christ, us. So there are two tracks of who these descendants are. One track is Israel, still today. Israel, the nation, and then also the church of Jesus Christ through Abraham. There are these two entities that God says, if you bless these entities, I will bless you. If you curse these entities, I will curse you. And that's a promise from God. This now, God is love, but God also means business. Can I just be honest? So I'm gonna bring something kind of current into this and then I'll get moving with the rest of my message. There's a lot of opinions out there and I know the whole Israel thing right now is super controversial, but you know me, I'm gonna talk about it. So here's how I feel about this. It's not how I feel, it's from the word of God, therefore I feel. When God tells Abraham, whoever blesses this people, I will bless, and whoever curses it, I will curse. Did you know that there are books written, and I encourage you to do your own research, it's fascinating. Anytime there was a nation, an empire, a civilization, or a people group that turned their backs on Israel, immediately, that civilization, empire, or people group began to deteriorate and crumble. It was almost instantly, every single time. But when nations blessed Israel, that nation, that people group was blessed. Look at America. Blessing starts shifting when nations start shifting. And I think this is so interesting. Now, I want to be very careful here. Where a lot of people go kind of weird with this is just because I feel like it's our responsibility to back Israel, that doesn't mean I'm anti-Palestinians. Because Jesus died for all people. God loves all people. Even the people, yes, even the people who have made God their enemy, God has not made them his enemy, right? We saw that when Jesus looked at Peter, when Peter cut off the guard's ear in the Garden of Gethsemane in the New Testament, Jesus gets on to Peter, not the guard that was coming to arrest Jesus. What he was showing Peter is, just because they've made me their enemy does not mean I've made them my enemy. So I'm not talking about making people enemies, but what I am saying is, as a believer, that passage in Genesis transcends time, and we're living in it right now. Pretty interesting, right? All right, I'll keep moving. So Abraham, at the moment of this promise, it's interesting, he was 70 years old. 70 years old when God gives him a promise. Some of you guys today are thinking, I don't know if I've ever received what I feel like from God, my purpose is, my calling is. Abraham was 70 years old. And he says, this is what's gonna happen. What was interesting about this moment in Abraham's life, Abraham had no children at 70 years old. So you're a 70-year-old guy, and God says your descendants are gonna just number the stars of the sky. And he's like, God, I'm 70, and my wife's my age. So what's gonna happen here, God? I'm 70. And then 10 years go by, nothing. 10 years, which makes Abraham how old? 80. In Genesis 15, yeah, you guys are with me. In Genesis 15, 5, after 10 years, God comes back and reinforces the promise, but doesn't bring the promise with him. He said, he took him outside. He says, look up at the sky and count the stars. Indeed, if you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Now you can imagine being Abraham. He was 70. Oh, this is awesome. 10 years pass. Now he's 80. And then God comes back to him and says, look up at the sky. See the stars? That's your descendants. And he's going, God, I'm 80. My wife is my age. What's gonna happen here? I'm 80. What's gonna happen here? But God again brings the promise, but not the promise itself. And I'll be honest, I think a lot of us in this room today can identify with Abraham at this point in the story. We felt like God has promised us something, and we've been waiting, and we've been waiting, and we've been waiting. And we're at this point now where it's like, God, I mean, you're not doing what I thought you were gonna do. At the time, I thought you were gonna do this thing. What's gonna happen? I felt like you promised me I wasn't gonna be alone for the rest of my life. I felt like you promised me this was gonna happen with my job, or you promised me this, or God, I felt like this was a promise. God, what's happening? I've been doing everything you said to do. What's happening? And we start thinking all of a sudden, we're at the beginning of the promise, we're honored that God would even think of us. And toward this point, 10 years later, Abraham's like, God, you should be honored that I stuck around, right? And we start sliding and slipping into that mindset. But I'll be honest, and we live in a society right now where we don't like waiting. We are impatient. We don't like waiting. And I am going to say I am probably I'm very impatient. I'll say it like that. I don't like waiting. I have this like embedded mental clock at a restaurant that once we order, I kind of just know when the food should be brought out. And if it's not there, you guys have that kind of clock in your head. I'm not even looking at the clock. I just kind of know. You can feel it. When the chips and salsa run out, when you're on your second glass of water, you're like, what the heck? Like, what's going on here? You know, I need my food. You know, and I start doing this, and Mandy's looking at me, and she's like, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm okay. I'm okay. I don't like waiting. And she's like, what's going on? I'm like, I don't know. Should I talk to somebody? Maybe they forgot about us. No, they didn't forget about us, Dustin. You're fine. I'm like, okay, breathing exercises. I just don't like waiting. I don't like long lines. I don't like waiting at a red light. If there's three lanes and one lane has five cars, one lane has four cars, and one lane has three cars, and I'm in the far left lane, I'm veering over and getting in the lane with three cars. And guess what happens to me every single time? The lane with five cars goes faster. Does that happen to you guys too? Okay. But I don't like waiting. And when it comes to the things of God, none of us like waiting. Because we feel like if God promised it, it needs to happen now. And we don't like the waiting. And Abraham had to have been thinking, and his wife Sarah, God may have promised something, but he's not delivering on his promise. In chapter 16, what we find is Abraham and Sarah start taking the situation into their own hands, and they start looking at God and thinking, well, you promised this, but I think I might be able to fulfill this promise a little bit better than you can. We're gonna take matters into our own hands. Sarah decides they've waited too long, and she suggests something to Abraham that if you've read this story a lot, you might have become numb to how dumb and weird this is, what I'm about to tell you, but this is weird. Sarah comes to Abraham and says, hey, so we can't get pregnant. We're in our 80s, but I have a servant girl named Hagar. Why don't you sleep with her? And if you have a child, the son will still be yours, and maybe that's God's will. Have you ever like thought about these Bible characters and you think, Abraham, he's just amazing. Probably never did anything wrong. You know, he just always walked with God, always had faith. And then he hears this and he goes, that's a great idea. What could go wrong? So I'm gonna read the passage, but a lot went wrong. In Genesis 16, 1-4, now Sarai or Sarah, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian servant named Hagar. So she said to Abram, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my servant. Perhaps I can build a family through her. Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian servant, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar, and she conceived. When she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. So when Sarah found out Hagar was pregnant, she began to despise Hagar. So did you ever look at like dumb decisions people make and then they get mad at the outcome and you're like, you made the dumb decision, right? And now you have the dumb outcome. It's the same thing with Sarah. She's like, sleep with my servant girl. And if you get pregnant, it's gonna be great. If she gets pregnant, it's just gonna be great. The moment she gets pregnant, jealousy, envy, and everything bad starts happening. So we're at the low point in this story, but I'm gonna go quickly through three things I wanna show you. When it comes to us receiving the promise of God, we need to learn three things from this story, and we will be able to see our lives intertwined with the story of Abraham and Sarah like crazy. The first one is this. We need to see the reason for his disobedience, Abraham's disobedience. What was the reason for his disobedience? Now, there's never an excuse for disobedience, but sometimes there are reasons for disobedience. When we're disobedient to God's word, disobedient to God himself, there are reasons, there are indicators, there are things that begin to happen that lead towards disobedience. And the first one is this. They desired cultural acceptance. They desired cultural acceptance. At that time in society, it was considered a disgrace to be childless. In multiple different religions and different people groups back then, if you were childless or barren, people viewed it as a curse from God, which is not true, but it was a disgrace in society to not be able to have children. Also at that period of time, it was viewed as normal to have multiple wives or concubines. Now, sometimes when we read in scripture, people have asked me, you know, how can you even take the Old Testament seriously if like people like Abraham took on Hagar as his wife and had a concubine? And what I tell them is very simple as this. Just because the Bible records something does not mean the Bible condones something, unless it specifically condones it. Because him having a concubine and taking in Hagar was an absolute sin, and the Bible makes it clear that it was. It was a sin. And I want to say this, just because something is normal in society does not make it godly, and just because something is natural does not make it godly or holy. Right? Okay, yeah, you can clap or whatever, I don't care. Godly, it doesn't. So when we think about what's normal going on, that slippery slope, what I talked about in our Resilient Faith series this spring, when that line starts moving of what we start blending normal out there to normal in the church, some bad things begin to happen. The second reason for their disobedience is they became desensitized to sin. After the first promise from God to Abraham, they were driven into Egypt because of a famine and a drought in the land. They weren't supposed to go to Egypt, though. They were supposed to trust God and go somewhere else. So they went to a land they were not supposed to go to, but they spent a lot of time there. Now, I want to tell you something. When you settle in the wrong place, over time, you become the place. Now, that place is figurative or literal, but when you begin to settle with the wrong friend group, settle with the wrong job, settle around the wrong people, when you decide to build camp and to let down your roots in the wrong places, eventually, if you're not careful, you will become desensitized to sin. And that's exactly what happened. When they first went into Egypt, because the Bible says Sarah was so beautiful, Abraham had this plan. He said, if we go into Egypt and Pharaoh sees how beautiful you are, he's gonna, and you're my wife, he's gonna kill me so he can take you as his wife. He says, so we're gonna go in and we're gonna say you're my sister, so at least I'll live and you can still be his wife. Abraham's a straight up dude, right? So that's what happens. Pharaoh takes her in to be his concubine, later finds out that Abraham lied and kicks them out of Egypt. But when they were in Egypt, they were also not supposed to collect things, but they did. And one of the things they took in people was Hagar. They took on servants from Egypt, which God asked them not to take, but they became desensitized while they were there. And when you're desensitized to sin, you start making excuses for sin, and you even start thinking that God approves of the sin. The next reason is they doubted the promise of God. They doubted God's promises. When the promise was first given, Abraham reacted with great faith. I showed you that. But as time went by, he began to doubt. So he and Sarah, like I mentioned, decided that God needed a little bit of help to fulfill this promise. And guys, I know we're all guilty of this. We're all guilty of this. I know you're gonna do it, but just let me help a little bit. Like, I know a lot too. Like, just let me help, and I can kind of speed this up along. Like, you may not have completely approved of this girl or this guy I want to date, but trust me, they check all the boxes. I'm just going to jump into that relationship, and I'm sure you're going to condone of it later. That's not how God works, right? So we see this stuff start to happen. They start doubting the promise of God, take things into their own hands, and you can imagine this is probably the mindset they had. After all, God said that Abraham would father a son, right? She's probably looking at Abraham, that you would father a son, but he didn't technically say from whom you would father a son, so I have an idea. And they both apparently thought it was good. But isn't that interesting that the same twist she took on what God said, that's the way Satan tempts and always tempted and even tempted Adam and Eve in the garden. God said, do not eat the fruit from that tree, right? Satan comes in and says, did God really technically say that? Or could it have been that? You know, Satan's goal is to never in your first step to take you completely off track because it's too obvious. Satan will never lead you up to a cliff and go, jump, I promise you'll survive. You'll be like, no, that's dumb. I'm not jumping off this cliff of sin. I know what's gonna happen. But Satan will show you a slope and he'll say, you can handle that slope. Did God really say? Did God really say? And he does it over and over and over again. He did it with Abraham and Sarah, and they began to doubt God's promise. And we do it. We do the exact same thing. We do the exact same thing with relationships, with new jobs, new schools. We maybe have been single for longer than we wanted to be, and then here comes someone that shows us attention, and they don't necessarily meet all the standards that God put in our lives, and here comes Satan. Well, I mean, but he's such a good guy, right? Like, look, I mean, look at his smile. He laughs. The last guy you dated didn't even laugh. You're like, seriously, like, those are the kinds of things you're like, you're right. That's the most important thing for a marriage, you know? That, but that's how quickly people start getting skewed off course. And we start making excuses and we land in relationships and marriages that are so destructive, and it goes all the way back to the beginning of that first, when Satan first whispers in your ear. Now, I know they don't technically meet the full standard of what God would expect, but he raises your eyebrows, you engage, and then destruction. And we see it happen over and over, and with jobs. I have seen so many people, and I want us to really think about this for a minute, and then I'll keep moving. Every person I talk to, if you're somewhere, you know, in Albuquerque and there's a job offer somewhere else, or you're watching online and they're even moving to a different part of Albuquerque, or a different job or a different role in your job, people always equate an opportunity for more money, a raise, or a new job to being God's will. Well, they offered me a new job and it pays a whole lot more. Isn't God good? And I'm like, that may not be God. You wanna know how many people I have seen uproot their families that were thriving in this church, move to a different city because of a raise, and their kids completely walked away from God? Guarantee God didn't move that family to that city for that raise for their kids to walk away from God. I think sometimes we have to really get back to the basics of this and stop saying God said unless he did. Don't say God said unless he did. And most of the time it's with a multitude of counselors coming together, godly people, and us making decisions together in community where you really settle in God's will and find what God really wants. But we all get antsy and we like to take things into our own hands. Number two, in the main points, we have to look at the result of his disobedience. The result of his disobedience. Number one was the reason for his disobedience. Number two is the result of his disobedience. We kind of see this obviously. The first result was a difficult son was born, Ishmael. In Genesis 16, 11 through 12, the angel of the Lord also said to her, he's talking to Hagar, you are now pregnant and you will give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard of your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. King James Version uses a different word there. His hand will be against everyone and everyone's hand against him, and he will live in hostility toward all his brothers. Ishmael, if you don't know biblical history, Isaac began the true lineage of Judaism, and Ishmael began the true lineage of Islam. And still today, these brothers, the spirit of these brothers, are still at war, and it's something God said back then. A difficult son was born. Ishmael in this story is a real person, but for us today, he also represents the difficulties that arise when sin is allowed to divert us from the plan of God in our lives. What's your Ishmael? What is the thing that you will give birth to if you don't stop the pattern of sin in your life? Sin eventually will give birth to something. The Ishmael in this story, we see as a real person, but figuratively again for us today, if we start a pattern of sin, eventually there's gonna be an Ishmael. Eventually there's going to be something that will last a lifetime, that will be there, that God will, he could forgive and will forgive if we come to him, but it will still be there. So many people aren't thinking about the future when they're looking at their current decisions they're making. Every friendship matters. Everywhere you go matters. Everything you look at online matters. Everybody you follow on social media matters. Every substance you take matters. Everything you do for fun, what you do to medicate matters. Everybody you date matters. It all matters because any one of those decisions could become the beginning of a new pattern in your life. And those patterns, if they're sinful, will give birth to Ishmaels. A difficult something in your life that could last forever. The second result of the disobedience was a dysfunctional family was burdened. Genesis 21, 9 through 11 says, "But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar, the Egyptian, had borne to Abraham was mocking, and she said to Abraham, 'Get rid of the slave woman and her son.'" How quickly her language changed. "For the woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac. The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son." It became quickly dysfunctional. But Abraham is now caught in this story that he can't get out of because of his own decision. Ishmael is not the promised son, but he's still his son. Ishmael is now part of the story. Whether Abraham or Sarah want him to be, he is part of the story. And now Abraham is distressed. Another word there is Abraham has anxiety. How much of our anxiety is actually because of decisions we've made that we're carrying with us because an Ishmael was born? And now we're living in this bed of anxiety that we're trying to wrestle through and work through because of our own decisions. So even after many years, their past sin brought heartache and trouble into the home. Now, most of this is bad news so far. You ready for the good news? Here's the but. But the third thing, the third result is a divine plan was restored. A divine plan was restored. And that's interesting under this point of the result of disobedience. How can a divine plan be restored as a result of disobedience? Because that's how good and big and gracious our God is. A divine plan was reinforced. Genesis 21, 10 through 12. "So she turned to Abraham and demanded, 'Get rid of that servant girl and her son. He is not going to share the inheritance with my son, Isaac. I won't have it.' This upset Abraham very much because Ishmael was his son. But God told Abraham, 'Do not be upset over the boy and your servant. Do whatever Sarah tells you, for Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted.'" Now, this might sound a little bit harsh in what God is doing here, but he's drawing a line. What he's showing us today is this, and what he was telling Abraham: get your eyes off of the consequences and the weight of what you're carrying from the past, and get your eyes on the promise that's still alive. The promise of God for your life is still alive. It doesn't matter how much sin is in your past. It doesn't matter how many Ishmaels have been born in your past. Isaac is still alive. There is still hope for your future. There is still hope for what God has called you to do, because God's plan, all the days of your life have been numbered. All the days of your life have been planned. God knows your life, and no decision we make is bigger and more powerful than the sovereignty of God. Our decisions matter, but God's sovereignty is bigger. What do I mean by that? It doesn't mean that we can just go behave and do anything we want and everything's gonna end up okay. Because what we find, and I wanna read this passage real quick before I get to number three, because this is so important. It's in the New Testament, Romans 8, 28. Paul wrote this and he said, "And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called..." See, it's ringing too, perfect time. "Who have been called according to his purpose. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." Here's the good news. You've been called according to his purpose. God works all things for the good. It doesn't mean that every day is good. It doesn't mean all our decisions are good. But what we'll find is that through genuine repentance, which I'll get to in a second, things can begin to turn around. Let me tell you something. I have sat with so many people, even in recent weeks, where I've looked across the table from someone who's made the worst decisions of their entire life. And they feel like everything's over, everything's gone because of the decisions they've made. And I've looked them in their eyes and I'll say this. I'll say, if you hang on to God, if you just hang on to God, if you hang on to church, if you stay connected to the body of Christ, if you just hang on, today's not good. Yesterday wasn't good. Tomorrow may not be good. But if you just hang on, there will be a day in the future where you look back and you will see the thread of God's goodness working everything together for your good if you just hang on. That's the promise from Romans chapter 8. He works all things for good. All things aren't good, but he works all things for good. Number three, we have to look at the impact of his repentance. The impact of his repentance. Repentance is what gives us a chance at another chance, which is actually the title of my message today, a chance at a second chance. What gives us that chance? Repentance. What is repentance? Repentance is one of those kind of churchy, doctrinal words that some people have a hard time with because we see people preaching, standing on street corners, yelling at people to repent. Repent is a very, it's an awesome word. It's a powerful word, but it's super practical. What repentance is, it, meaning this, I'm on this path going away from the things of God or just veered slightly from the things of God. And when I repent, it is a willful decision that I make to resubmit to the will of God. So repentance is I'm going this way and now I'm not. I'm gonna stop going this way. I'm gonna put my will in check now and I'm gonna submit my will to God's will and get back on track and follow Jesus and realign in God's will. What is God's will? His word is his will. I'm gonna submit to his word. Am I gonna be perfect? No, I'm gonna stumble and fall, but when I'm facing the right direction, when I fall, he picks me up and I keep going forward. But I can't live a life in opposition to God and expect all things to work for the good of me. All things work for the good of those who are called according to his purpose, not ours. Not the one I want for my life, but the purpose God wants for my life. Here's what I love about God. Here's what I love about God. He hasn't given up on you and he never will, ever. So many of you, I've had conversations with some of you. And if you're like me, when you make poor decisions, you just can't help but think, if you're a humble person, you just can't help but think, he's done with me. I'm not worthy anymore because of what I've done. But that's how great he is. If we just resubmit and repent, things begin to get back on track. Here's the miracle of God's grace. Despite the mess that Abraham made in chapter 16, God's message to Abraham in chapter 17 is essentially this. My yes, Abraham, means yes. Your mess cannot mess up my plan. And that's what he's telling you. Your last chapter in your life might have been a mess. And it might have been because of your decisions. But what God wants to tell you today with realignment, with resubmission to his will, with getting under the lordship of Jesus Christ today, what God is telling you is your last chapter might be a mess, but I can take that mess and I can make a message out of that mess and I will get you back on track on purpose and getting moving toward the promise I have for your life. But the question today is, will you, should you, repent? There's that word. What do I mean? Genesis 17, 1 through 7. When Abram was 99 years old, 99. This is how long this promise has been in effect. The Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Can you imagine being Abraham at 99? This started at 70. He's at 99, you're like, God, if you say this one more time, that I'm gonna increase in number. You know, if you say this one more time, 99 years old. But I love what God says. If you'll walk and you'll be blameless. Well, I'm sitting here reading this though. I can't be blameless. I can't be blameless. So I have to be perfect? Yes and no. Can I tell you how? Why yes? How we today can be blameless in the sight of God is through what Jesus did on the cross for us. Jesus was blameless and he knew none of us would ever be. That is the amazing nature of the cross. When Jesus died on the cross and we look to Jesus as our Savior and call upon the name of Jesus to be my Lord and Savior, what happens is all the things in my life that make me have blame, my sin, my past, my regret, my failures, when I submit to Jesus and what he did on the cross, all that sin and failure dies with him. And then I get the righteousness and blamelessness of Jesus clothed around me, where God says, you're blameless. Now, the promise I've always had for you. is intact. Now, some of you are thinking, well, I've been a Christian for a long time, and I feel like even since I've been a Christian, I've kind of stumbled and maybe walked away a little bit, and I don't know, I kind of feel like God might be done with me. The good news is repentance is kind of double-faceted, multifaceted in a way. I'll tell you how. The big repentance is what I just said, submitting to Jesus to be our Lord and Savior. But there's also these moments in our lives, even as believers, where I'm still saved, I'm still a Christian, I just had a rough season. Like, I might be going to heaven, but I'm not acting like it here. That's another version of repentance where we just need to say, I'm stopping the path I'm walking on and I'm turning around. And I love it in this passage. It continues in verse 3 and it says, Abram fell face down. And God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. It was like a key that unlocked the promise of God. Abraham fell face down. And then God, the next word says, here comes the promise. Oh, I love it. I love it. Listen to this, that how vast and how big this promise is. As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you. And kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. Something was unlocked that day. And the evidence we have is that it came from Abraham falling face down in repentance. It doesn't necessarily have to be a physical act for you, but when was the last time, figuratively and spiritually speaking, you fell face down and said, God, less of me means more of you. John the Baptist said that in the New Testament. We say, God, I'm so exhausted from trying to live my life my own way. I am exhausted. I'm full of anxiety. I can barely sleep. I'm having to go to therapy. I am so tired of wrestling you, God. I just want to fall face down and I want my chance at a second chance. I want to do it your way. We like to control, but the promise of God, just like with Abraham that day, comes with complete abandon, where you just say, I'm done. I'm done doing it my way. I'm so exhausted. God, will you still take me? And his answer every single time is yes, 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 and yes. But it comes through falling face down. When he changed his name from Abram to Abraham, I don't have time, and I'm ending right here. I don't have time to go into all of this, but Abram essentially meant an exalted father. Abraham meant father of multitudes. It was an extension. Isn't it interesting that through repentance, the cap that we feel like has been put on our lives is taken off. The lid is taken off, where we think, this is all God has for me. This is it. This is all the fulfillment I'm ever gonna have. This is everything life is ever gonna be. No, take the lid off. Come back to God and say, I want less of me and more of you. Even if you're doing well spiritually, come back to God and say, God, I wanna go to the next level with you. What are the areas of my life I haven't fully submitted? I wanna submit everything to you, God. I want the life completely for what you want for my life. That's what I want. And the lid keeps being taken off and taken off. Why just be an exalted father when you can be a father of nations where kings can come from you and descendants forever will be blessed by you? That's the promise that God has for our lives. That's the promise. No matter what's in your past, this is the scripture I want to leave you with today. Romans 8:38 says this, nothing. Say that first word with me on the count of three. One, two, three. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing, no decision, no mistake, nothing. The thing that the enemy keeps putting in your ear when you lay your head down at night, when you're alone, and the thing that people keep telling you God can't use, this word is a big word, nothing. In the original Greek, it means nothing. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. And if it's true, and it is, why not own it? Nothing you've done has made God love you less. Nothing. Today, step in to your second chance. We're gonna end today with singing the song we sang earlier, House of Miracles. And in this song, there's a part of it that talks about how God works all things for good. And I want you today, as we sing this song, to sing it with everything in your heart. And if you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, right before we sing this song, very quickly, I wanna pray with you, because I do not want you to leave today without this opportunity. If you're here today, when I talked about what Jesus did on the cross and we get his righteousness and he took our sin, here's what happened on the cross. When I received Jesus as my Savior, when I call on his name, Jesus, come into my life, cleanse me, that's all I have to do. My sin dies with him on that cross. And then because Jesus came out of the grave, it means my sin stays dead forever. And now it means I'm covered. And even if I stumble and fall in the future, God's grace is still there to clothe me, cover me, and pick me back up. Today, if you want to be included in this final prayer to receive Christ as your Savior, every head bowed and every eye closed just for a moment. On the count of three, if you would just raise your hand right where you're at, and I want to include you in this prayer. It's a big thing. I know I'm moving quickly on this, but I want this to be your moment. Let it be your moment right now. He's the God of second chances. If that's you and you want to be included, on the count of three, raise your hand. One, two, three, right where you're at. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Right where you're at. Keep them raised just for a second. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You can put them right back down. Pray with me today. And if you raised your hand, make this prayer your own. Raising your hand doesn't save you. Even praying a prayer in general doesn't save you. What saves you is calling upon the name of the Lord. Jesus, be my Savior. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you're saved. You don't have to know everything. You just have to know that. He's done all of the work for you. Father, you see every hand that went up and you see every heart right now. God, those of us that are giving you our lives right now, I just pray that you would, like you promised, cover us with your grace and your mercy. Jesus, we call on your name right now. Come into our lives. Cleanse us from the inside out. You are the God that we will serve. I know we'll be imperfect, but Jesus, you are there to cover us and to pick us back up. I will give you my whole heart and all of me as the Lord and Savior of my life. We thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.